Hey everyone, Internet PCS Book Reader here. Today I want to talk about Curse Bread by Sophie McIntosh. This is one of those stories that got really weird, but I kinda like it when an author goes sicko mode and wrote the equivalent of a fever dream as long as it is well written. But I'm getting ahead of myself. The story opens up in a bakery where Elodie, our main character, the baker's wife, works in the counter of the bakery. She's in a bit of an unhappy marriage and is just bored with the repetitive nature of her life. Her husband cares more about the craft of his baking, while it makes him the best baker in town with the best bread, but everything and everyone else become secondary to his life, including Elodie. This is how Elodie described her husband in the book. He was on a constant mission to perfect it. You might have said this not entirely seriously, but he was very serious about it. I was jealous too of the purity of his focus, the incremental moves towards one faultless loaf. But then what, when there was nothing left of the bread to improve? What then? Eat of it and be filled. Eat of it and be transformed. Eat of it and nothing changes. The almost imperceptible recalibration of our desires or satisfaction. Try again. Then one day, the ambassador and his wife Violet come into the city. Elodie was immediately obsessed with Victoria and her husband. She started to want to show off, becoming closer to Violet, and there was a weird scene in the forest lake where she saw the ambassador skinny dipping alone for some reason. And while Elodie's obsession with the couple grew stronger, a lot of strange things are happening. A man apparently pulled his own heart out, 6 horses was found dead, all lined up perfectly, a boy ran into the bonfire in a festival, and for some reason, the ambassador said to Violet not to eat the bread because it might kill her. There are a lot of good things about this book. The writing is amazing. There's so much show don't tell that you can tell that the story is located in a quiet and small town without even once mentioning any place or location. Even the time you can tell, even if no year was mentioned in the story. There was no technologies that we have taken for granted feature in the story. A car once came out and it was quite a big deal that we kinda know just from the context the era the story took place in. There was also a section that mentioned La Foyer. Well, it didn't mention that it's a washing place where women bring their laundry back then. It mentioned bags of clothes, so we know that it has something to do with clothing just from context. One of my major complaints about the previous book I read, Another Person by Kang Wakil, was that it's trying to overexplain characters and situation. Long dialogues and exposition that, even if not told, doesn't make a difference to the story it's telling. It's such a stark difference reading that book and this book back to back, where to understand the story you're going to need extra attention so you don't miss any details. And the prose-like quality of the writing is amazing. Here's a few more quotes I really like. Perhaps you can walk a thing away, or walk yourself away, wear yourself into a slip of sinew. The trick is forgetting for one moment, and then forgetting for another moment, and then look, the moments runs together with a string of beats. And there is heartbreak in the forgetting of heartbreak, in the forgetting of pain, which returns bright and pulsing regardless of the second it has been put aside. Do not leave me here, it tells you. Pain becomes an animal, walking at your side. Pain becomes a home you can carry with you. Nobody at the beginning believes they will debase themselves for love. Nobody believes in anything else but joy. I remember the precise choreography of her movements, the raising of her hand a few centimeters, the shift of her face away. Also, I guess it's kind of a warning, the story is really horny, or more specifically, Elodie is so horny for the ambassador and Violet to the point of almost uncomfortable to read. If not because of how Violet always play along with Elodie and push her to be more daring. A lot of the scene is so extra with sexual tension and I was reading it outside. Yes, I read book outside, shut up. And I felt bad for reading it outside, like I'm doing something wrong. Not like I'm a bad boy who needs punishment kind of way. More like I feel like I'm doing a public indecency crime. I might be a degenerate, but I'm not that far gone of degenerate. But again, with the quality of the writing, for the most part, nothing explicit is being shown or depicted in the book. The tension, or more specifically the sexual tension, is built more on what is not being said than what is being said. I wish I can explain it better. But with that said, unfortunately, most of the second half of the story is just weaker version of the first half, because most of it are just basically, oh, will something happen here? I wonder if something will happen here. Oh no, nothing happened yet again, and it's on repeat. Also, the story of the book, as what I think I'll title the YouTube video with, is based on an incident in 1951 where a small French town of, sorry about my friends here, Pont Saint-Esprit had a mass poisoning incident. This incident led to mass hysteria and hallucination, where the town started seeing things. Some people died because of this, like the boy that threw himself into a fire in the story, and a few others who took out their own heart, learned to fly from the top of their house, or a boy choking his own mother. And a lot of others had to be submitted to an asylum. And ever since that incident, there has been a lot of theories. For example, one of them is of course about mercury poisoning, because it's the 50s and everyone is using mercury for everything back then. And although none of these theories have been proven as the one theory that definitely caused it, one of the most popular and the leading theory right now is Cursed Bread or Pain Motif, the title of the book. Because during the investigation, most of the victims bought their bread from the same bakery, and that bakery apparently bought some of the grain from another baker that did a few suspecting to make the grain cheaper to produce. And the bread made from that certain grains contain ergot, some fungus that cause LSD-like hallucination when it is eaten. Unfortunately, a lot of this don't really have much to do with the story, not really. Well, it does set as the background of the story, and also it helps in making Elodie such an unreliable narrator since it is hinted that the baker with suspect grain is from her place. But since the story doesn't really have much of an escalation to the plot, the story itself feels like they're not going anywhere important, and then suddenly everyone in town has gone crazy, while Elodie still busy being horny for Violet and her possession, including her husband, the ambassador. Well, I'm sure that the incident in the town is also a sudden without any indication prior to it, since that's usually the case with mass hysteria. But since it is a fiction, I kinda wish there's a better flow to the story. Some of the events don't connect all that well. The suspicious dead horses kinda feel like they're there to give cheap shock factor to the story, because nothing else happened during those times besides Elodie and Violet just doing nothing together while Elodie is up on her own head with her own fantasies. There was also the event prior to the end of the book where a boy ran to a bonfire to set himself on fire, but there doesn't seem to be any reaction that sells the gravity of the events. The town was in a more talkative mood during the stupid horse event, which makes the boy on fire seems like a much less weird occurrence. The storytelling also did one of those things that go back and forth between two timelines, and in this book we follow Elodie in the present with the arrival of Violet and the ambassador. Then we follow some kind of journal or diary entry from future Elodie as if she's writing a letter to Violet. Well, part of it shows how much involvement she had in the incident, since the cops are interviewing her about the incident in the town, and it also shows how much she's still obsessed with Violet despite all the humiliation that had happened between them. But most of the time, nothing really important is happening in future Elodie's life. So it mostly only contributes to how it makes the story feels like there's no escalation of anything during the second half of the book. It's one of those flat lines of a story that failed to make the story engaging. I give this a 3.25. What do you think? Are you going to read it? And did I miss anything? Leave your thoughts in the comment below and subscribe to the channel. That's about it.